Hey, this is John Zombro with the Lifetime Athlete, where we celebrate athletes of every type, age, and ability, and try to make people hard to kill on the playing field and in the game of life. Today's discussion is going to be, let's call it the 2023 training shoe update. Now, in my work in coaching and physical therapy and performance enhancement, I work with a lot of different athletes. I do work with a lot of runners, and so most years we'll have a running shoe update just to keep up with the technology and help people with some of those recommendations. I'll probably do that in a separate video. So today is going to be the training shoe update. Now I'll try to explain what I'm getting after with this selection of shoes here in front of me. First of all, in many of the programming elements that we utilize, we use hiking, backpacking, rucking, and for those applications, we generally will recommend a lightweight hiking shoe for most people. It does a great job, especially when you're on more technical trail or terrain, but a lot of times you can get away with simply using a running shoe or a trail running shoe when things are not too challenging. Let's take this off the table. Not necessarily going to talk about that today because I've talked about applications for backpacking and backcountry hunting quite a bit in some other videos. Then, let's also keep in mind that if you play a sport, a specialized shoe is often indicated. So that could be golf or tennis, basketball, soccer, track and field, you name it. So certain shoes will provide better lateral stability or function in those applications. So when you're playing your sports, we want you to be using a specific shoe. And if you're on the track and you're doing sprinting, obviously a spike is going to be something that you'll want to consider. Now I'm going to take these off the table as well. You see how we're going to refine this list down. Next up would be, let's say you are that runner who runs a lot. Now, not every person, every lifetime athlete runs a ton or needs to. We just need to be able to run some in our mindset or our community. But for those people who are very passionate about running, they end up running quite a bit on roads. I'm okay with some amount of road running for most people. I generally don't like to recommend running on concrete. So the asphalt's slightly softer, at least in the warmer temperatures. In fact, a lot of times when I have athletes who are traveling and all they have available is concrete, I usually recommend walking instead of running just to reduce some of the ground reaction forces and joint stresses that can happen. Occasionally there'll be pushback on that, but nonetheless, that's how I roll. But if a person is running a lot on these asphalt and road surfaces, I usually recommend more cushioning in the shoe. I like minimalist shoes for some applications, but with road running, I'm going to say using a maximalist type shoe that has a very thick midsole. I'll generally find that that works better for most people. Prefer it myself if I were to do some of that. Or you could use one of the newer super shoes as well. These are the ones that have really the high stack height and the heel to 4 foot differential, the carbon plate within them. What a lot of people notice in the recreational ranks, however, is those shoes are often tuned to the more elite competitors who probably get more out of those shoes. That's why a lot of the record books in particularly distance running have been rewritten over the last couple years. Not just the talent and hard work of these athletes, but the shoes are contributing a bit. So one of my suggestions for many folks is, hey, let's make sure we get your body weight, your body composition, your running form and technique really dialed in first before you get a shoe like that so you can get the most out of it. But when we take all that out and we say, well, what type of training am I talking about here? Well, I'm talking about the workouts that we are generally doing. And in a lifetime athlete model, what we do in the training tribe, what we do with our fit for the field, hunter conditioning program, and most of the athletes that I coach, I usually like to have them consider some uses for their footwear. So first off, if you said, hey, will one shoe do it all? And I'd say, yeah, of course, although there will be, or potentially could be some compromise. So let's say you use kind of what's known these days as just a trainer, a training shoe, a CrossFit style shoe. These shoes are light. They have some amount of cushioning. They usually have a sock-like upper, very flexible. So they work in the gym. You can run a little bit in these shoes. That's fine. One challenge I find, though, is that if we're doing any type of change of direction work or lateral work or pickup sport play, these really may not be optimal as far as providing that stability and control that you may need. So it just depends. This can work, especially if you only want to have one shoe. Then what a lot of people will say is, what about just a basic running shoe? So basic meaning a daily trainer type shoe. Usually it's kind of a road running shoe, so it's got some amount of tread, but it's not exceedingly aggressive. This will work across a variety of terrains. You'll still get enough traction on most trails that it's going to be fine, but it also doesn't have that wonky or clunky feeling, which you can have if you're running on smoother surfaces with a lot of tread. Probably the downside for these types of shoes is they often feel like too much shoe when you're on natural terrain such as grass or even artificial turf, where we really need more of a either a turf specific or minimalist type of shoe. So now I can finally get into talking about these shoes, which I've got in front of me. And this kind of represents, again, the lifetime athlete training approaches, but also what I end up recommending for most clients. First of all, we've got a minimalist shoe. Now, I've personally been wearing Innovates off and on for a number of years just because I like the fit. It tends to be a slightly narrow fit. They make some light but sturdy shoes. Every brand has its pros and cons, and I'm not recommending one brand over another because you have to definitely go through the process of trying on numbers of shoes and finding those ones that work best for you. However, this is a minimalist shoe. It's part of their Barefoot series, and this is the Bear XF210, but whatever. Again, it's almost like a slipper. And one of the things that you'll see a lot of times in the gym is folks, especially if they're doing deadlifts or kettlebell swings, they might just be in their socks. And that's great. That gives you a better foot interface with the ground for some of those types of activities, recruiting the posterior chain, etc. But I love a minimalist shoe because you get almost that same effect. Plus, you've got a little bit of traction and foot protection. So when you're doing some plyometrics or other exercises, just great. So I usually recommend for most of my serious athletes that they have a gym training shoe. One of the things that's quite valuable about that is most gym owners, or even in your own home, you'll appreciate if the shoe's dedicated to indoors. You're going to be tracking less dirt in, having less cleanup, and that's always a bonus. Now, the next thing that we do, so in our training model, we train in the gym. We train on natural surfaces when possible, so that could be sand. And of course, if you're on sand most of the time, I just say let's go barefoot completely. But a lot of times we're on grass at parks and fields, and sometimes artificial turf is available. Well, generally speaking, if a person's really into training on the grass and turf, I'll often suggest go ahead and getting a soccer or football cleat because it's really designed for that. You don't need much cushioning because the surfaces are cushioned well. You've got a lot of traction in those types of shoes, and you also have great lateral stability, which is great for change of direction drills, running 5-10-5s, etc. But I'll often use a shoe that's something like this, either a very lightweight trail shoe, so it's not overly high in the midsole, has some traction. I've also had a lot of success with using cross-country racing flats because I like that light and responsive feel for most of my grass training. And that works fairly well also. One thing I will say again, some of our grass training is done barefoot. We want that earthing and grounding effect, and we want the foot strengthening that can come from it. But again, when we're running, let's say max sprints and change of direction work, which we do as lifetime athletes at every age, a shoe like this can be helpful. Now we're getting down to the last two pairs that I wanted to talk about, and this is, let's say, a more aggro or full-on trail shoe, one that's got plenty of traction, aggressive outsole, some amount of midsole, some reinforcement in the upper. These work really well when you're doing your trail running and some lighter hiking applications, and they give you, again, a bit more confidence and security if you really are getting into those natural training venues. Then finally, we like to train on the track once in a while. So again, not necessarily does everyone need to be a track sprinter and own spikes, although when you go to the track, it's nice to have a running type shoe, which is a bit lighter, more flexible, a bit thinner in the midsole. One of the reasons is you don't need much cushioning on the track because generally those surfaces are a bit softer than our roads. And you don't want much tread at all because as long as you're getting enough grip, you want to have that solid contact with the track surface. So that's kind of what I recommend. So let me bring these all back and explain it one last time. Try to put them in the order that I had them. So, you know, if you're able to do so and you really want to maximize your experience in training, when you're in the gym, use a minimalist shoe. There are going to be some benefits to that. You get most of the benefits of being barefoot with some foot protection. Great. When you're out on the turf, if you really are dedicated to that, get some cleats, football or soccer, maybe some other choices as well, or use a very light trail shoe or cross-country type shoe. Then when you move to the serious trail work, kind of like we do sometimes in our summer programming where we go out and we hike and run in the mountains and lift boulders and jump in icy streams, this is a great style of shoe. And then a bit more responsive, lighter, thinner shoe for your track work. It will make a difference and you'll feel it. And that's really what I wanted to say with this training shoe update for 2023. Give our community, our audience, certainly some of the clients, a picture of what these shoes look like and some reasons behind their application. So, hey, thank you for joining me. And if you'd like more resources, just check out all the things that are available at thelifetimeathlete.com. Till next time, this is Coach Jay-Z signing out, and I'll talk to you soon.